and thought I was transgender since I was 15. I'm 21 now.
When I was 16, I decided that I was trans.
My name is Elle. I am a female to male to female detransitioner.
Hi, my name is Carrie. I'm a 22-year-old detransition woman. I was a pediatric transitioner, so I started medical transition when I was underage, and I stopped transitioning nearly a year ago.
Gender nonconformity is not the same as gender dysphoria. The Standards of Care version 7, this is the WPATH. Gender nonconformity refers to the extent to which a person's gender identity role or expression differs from the cultural norms prescribed for people of a particular sex. I'm going to read non-binary, and then I'm going to read androgynous. Non-binary describes any gender identity which does not fit the male and female binary spectrum. Those with non-binary genders can feel that they have an androgynous gender identity, such as androgen, have an identity between male and female, such as intergender. And now I'm going to read androgynous. Androgynous basically means partly male and partly female in appearance, okay? Androgyny is the combination of masculine and feminine characteristics into an ambiguous form. I'm reading all of this because sometimes when you talk to a non-binary person, they get offended when you kind of, you know, they explain what non-binary is and you're just like, oh, so you're androgynous, and they don't like that. Then you conclude that, oh, well, it sounds like you're just gender nonconforming, and they don't like that. But based off of every definition I've just read, it's very, very similar. The wording is off a little bit, but for the most part, they're all just not conforming. Now, I'm not saying this to invalidate anybody's identity, but, and I will go ahead and recognize this fact, I understand that some people who are gender nonconforming have dysphoria. I also understand that some people that are non-binary have dysphoria as well. So I'm not going to deny that. I understand that's actually an issue for some. But what I find rather interesting in all of this is, how did we get here, and is this part of the problem? Blurring the lines of what things mean, and why did we feel like gender nonconformity needed to be added in this? Now, I will admit, though, I don't know that gender nonconforming was added in version 7. I don't know that it was in there before that, so I'm not too clear on that. Personally, me, though, I feel like this is unnecessary, because if you're just talking about your expression, you know, again, I'll read, gender nonconformity refers to the extent to which a person's gender identity, role, or expression differs from the cultural norms. Okay, so if we're just talking about expression, role, you know, it adds gender identity, but gender nonconformity, to me, most people are not conforming to these gender expectations. And I don't think that they look at it as an identity. So that's very, very odd to me. I don't think it's a matter of I identify as gender nonconforming as much as it's, you know, I'm expressing my gender in a very nonconforming way. And it's just also very, you know, I think of these kids growing up today that are not conforming to these, to their gender, right? Like these gender nonconforming kids who typically, a lot of them tend to be like lesbian or gay men, right? And let's say they have a parent who's completely like not sure about what's going on. Their child's gender nonconforming. Maybe they take the child to a therapist, and now they're having this conversation about the possibility that your child is transgender and what that could mean. This could possibly lead to confusion. I don't feel that it's necessary to throw in gender nonconforming in here. I feel like when we're talking about gender dysphoria, yeah, obviously that's completely medical. That's an issue, you know? And that's also an issue that a lot of people deal with, and they're not necessarily transgender. Dysphoria is common. It's just when it's gender dysphoria to a severe extent that you want to transition, that now we're talking about, you know, transsexualism. So anyways, that's one thing I wanted to talk about there. Moving on.
So I have had in total 7 calls this year alone from very close people of mine that have basically told me they're detransitioning, or they've already detransitioned, and they're calling me with a whole nother voice. that I don't recognize because they've detransitioned.
I'll go ahead and drop the link down below for the video that I just pulled a clip from in case you want to watch the whole thing. I thought it was kind of important to show this specific clip. This is actually a trans man YouTuber who has been transitioning for 9 years, okay? And I felt that it says a lot when somebody who's been transitioning for that long, even his friends, are starting to detransition. So there's obviously an issue here, and it's bigger than most people want to admit. I see some people that have talked about it, right? Like, I've seen other YouTubers discuss it. I've seen people on Twitter, other social media platforms bring it up. And it's not that people are in denial, you know? Like, I feel that everybody's aware there are detransitioners. Nobody's denying that. I do believe that some people are acknowledging it and expressing far more concern than other people. Some people are so paranoid that TERFs or transphobic people are using detransitioners to push an agenda, which I completely understand that. Yes, that is possible. And yes, that in fact, I'll go ahead and say that some people are most definitely trying to do that. But just because there are some people that are trying to use detransitioners like a, you know, political pawn, right, to push their agenda, doesn't mean that we should be spooked from discussing this in a completely raw and honest way. Because regardless, this is going to bite us in the ass, because this directly does affect us, whether you want to admit it or not, because it will be used for political reasons, right? They'll either be using this as a way to, you know, claim that transition doesn't work at all, or they'll be using it in a way to where maybe they want to pull the option of allowing anybody to transition, right? I'm not saying that that will happen, but I can see how maybe somebody could want to use detransitioners in that way. But what do I mean by in a raw and sort of honest way is discussing this very thoroughly in a very detailed, honest way to where we're not concerned in how this could be used against us or anything like that. Because again, I will acknowledge some people might use detransitioners against us, but we cannot let that freak us out, because regardless, it's going to be talked about. And to me, it makes more sense for us to discuss it before other people use it for a political reason, right? And so when we're discussing detransitioners, I don't think it should be a matter of, okay, yeah, there is such a thing as detransitioners, that sucks, whatever. It should be more of, why is this happening? What do these three detransitioners have in common? Okay, they're all females. Okay, they were uncomfortable being butch lesbians. Okay, they had a eating disorder, you know what I mean? Like, we should actually get to the bottom of it and unpack the reasons why people are going to transition and how we could maybe slow down or entirely stop somebody from transitioning for the wrong reasons. Now, I know that me talking like this is probably scaring people off, because you're thinking, oh my god, you're just gatekeeping, you freaking true scrum. Chill. Like, it's not about gatekeeping to the point of making everybody's lives miserable, but some gatekeeping is clearly necessary. And once again, I go ahead and repeat, either we take care of our community and we talk about this and we address these issues, or we could ignore it and somebody else will. Regardless, it's not going away. The problem is way too big to sweep under the rug. So it makes far more sense for us to be open about this. It really sucks, trust me. I don't like talking about this stuff. I don't want to be having these conversations. It honestly, it sucks. So many of these stories keep popping up, and it hurts. It hurts to see this happen, because I cannot imagine being in their shoes, because dysphoria sucks, transitioning is a process, and to have to detransition, I imagine that's really heavy as well. So I'd rather not have these discussions. I'd rather not keep seeing these stories pop up. So it's a matter of making sure that we have access to HRT, but also making sure that the wrong people aren't transitioning. I say the wrong people, I mean somebody that maybe is suffering from some kind of dysphoria, but doesn't necessarily want to transition to the opposite sex, right? Because there is such a thing as being dysphoric, but you don't necessarily want to be a male or female. You're just super uncomfortable with your body. Okay, well, What kind of dysphoria is that, and how do we treat that? You know what? At this point, I don't know, because we're not talking about this. Dysphoria, as it stands right now, when people discuss dysphoria, or when you Google dysphoria, generally you're going to end up looking at gender dysphoria. So just put yourself in the shoes of a 14-year-old who's going through puberty. Puberty sucks for everybody. Maybe this person in particular has really just severe discomfort, right? They just, puberty is really bad for them. So they look things up. They're like trying to understand why they're so uncomfortable. They stumble across dysphoria, and then they scroll down and they come across gender dysphoria. Now they're thinking, wait, hold on. Am I this uncomfortable because maybe I'm not comfortable with my gender, or is it my body? And somebody that young could easily confuse one with the other. So now you have someone who is convinced that perhaps they are transgender. Maybe they express it to their parents. Maybe their parents take them to a therapist. Now they go to the therapist and there's like these signs and symptoms that are complete bullshit. And they've concluded that this kid is gender not conforming, which quite possibly means they're transgender. So what do? We put them on blockers, or we put them on HRT, and now we have somebody who's transitioning for perhaps the wrong reasons. 2 years later, they're detransitioning, and that is the most common thing that I keep seeing over and over again. So let's talk about dysphoria. What is gender dysphoria? Gender dysphoria involves a conflict between a person's physical or assigned gender and the gender with which he, she, they identify. People with gender dysphoria may be very uncomfortable with the gender they were assigned, sometimes described as being uncomfortable with their body, particularly developments during puberty, or being uncomfortable with the expected roles of their assigned gender. Now I'm going to go back for a second, and I'm going to scroll to the top. All I typed was dysphoria. Dysphoria comes up and it says it is defined as a state of unease or generalized dissatisfaction with life. Obviously, this is something that everybody, I think, could relate to on some level. Maybe at some point in their life, somebody felt that they were dissatisfied with their life. But if you scroll down, eventually you'll get to gender dysphoria, which isn't, I mean, you don't have to scroll very far to get there. So my point here is, could there not be some confusion in dysphoria? And is it possible that we have created somewhat of an issue in defining it like this? Because before it used to be called gender identity disorder, which I think I think that definition seems more fitting, less confusing. Because I mean, let's type gender identity disorder. Okay, gender identity disorder brings me to this, which brings me literally exactly to what I wanted. A disorder defined as GID, defined as disorders in which an individual exhibits marked and persistent identification with the opposite sex and persistent discomfort, dysphoria, with his or her own sex, or sense of inappropriateness in the gender role of that sex. So my point is, you know, it brings you more so, and then obviously there's like a bunch of dysphoria down here now because we've eradicated gender identity disorder, right? We don't want to use that because there's so much stigma. We want to destigmatize. I'm going to read this post that I came across on Reddit. This person posted and said, "Uncomfortable with my body, but not trans, and I don't know what I want." And this was posted 3 years ago. "I'm 16, female, don't like my physical, sexual characteristics, chest and genitals, and also feel ashamed of being a woman. I don't mean for this to be offensive at all, I'm just describing my own feelings. I'm not totally comfortable with my body and the femininity of it, specifically my boobs and vagina. It feels embarrassing to even type that. It feels embarrassing to see myself in a sexual manner. Masturbating makes me emotionally uncomfortable. I don't really like when I accidentally feel my own boob. I am just uncomfortable with having female sexual characteristics and a feminine body. Oddly enough, I am also uncomfortable when seeing another woman's vulva, even if I'm attracted to them. I'm bisexual. I hate the topics of female puberty and pregnancy. I feel that I would be uncomfortable with the topic of male puberty if I was male. As you can see, I just don't like seeing myself or being seen in a feminine or sexual manner. Let me clarify this. I am not transgender." I'm not going to read the rest of this, but my overall point is this is a common problem that I encounter with a lot of detransitioners. And in fact, I'm not trying to say that every non-binary person is like this, but there are a lot of people that I have either spoken to or I've watched videos of non-binary people, and the language, the things that they say echoes what this person says, because you're not comfortable with the idea of what a woman is or being a female. You now feel as though You have to find a escape plan to get out of this category and be seen as anything other than female, yet not necessarily male. There's nothing wrong with that, and I'm not saying there's something wrong with that, right? But could it be possible that maybe some people feel this way, happen to want to change certain things about their body, identify as non-binary, and that's fine. But could it be possible that there are some people that feel like this and don't want to identify as transgender, don't feel that they are transgender, but don't like the idea of being a woman, and therefore, like, what do we do with somebody like this, right? How can we help a female that doesn't feel that they're transgender, doesn't feel comfortable with her body? And that's kind of, in my opinion, a big problem that I see. A lot of the transitioners tend to feel this way. And as somebody that, you know, was born female, I can relate to some of this discomfort. I can't relate to not wanting to transition to be male, because that's where we differ. I can relate to some discomfort in my, you know, in being in my body, but I cannot relate to like the idea of not wanting to be male or not feeling like you are male or whatever the case.
Why would you change your body if you don't have dysphoria? Like, why would you do that to yourself? Because you're just going to end up with reverse dysphoria. And I actually also had an eating disorder, and I know people get offended by this, but I see a lot of parallels between anorexia.
There are. Because body dysmorphia.
Body dysmorphic disorder is characterized by obsessive thinking about a flaw on a specific part of your face or body that is often imagined or, if present, exaggerated in your mind and hardly noticeable to anyone else. The symptoms of BDD include compulsively checking the perceived flaw, attempting to minimize the appearance of the perceived flaw by covering it with makeup or clothing, and social isolation in order to keep the flaw or the symptomatic behavior a secret from others. There's a lot of things that I read here that sound very similar to gender dysphoria. With gender dysphoria, sometimes, depending on how severe it is or not, you will socially isolate, right? You might go out and you have gender dysphoria, but you'll feel social dysphoria. Therefore, you isolate and you don't want to be social. Another thing I would point out is the obsessive kind of compulsive thinking that comes with gender dysphoria. Very similar to body dysmorphic disorder, right? You're obsessing about something about yourself. The only differences that I see here have a lot to do with, one is the desire to transition to the opposite sex. The other one doesn't come with that, right? But the similarities remain, you know, we're kind of obsessing over these things that are a part of our body that feel like are wrong in some way. So it's important, if you are transgender or you think you are transgender, to look at these things, to compare what you're feeling to the definition of both body dysmorphic disorder and gender dysphoria. And take your time, okay? Like, I can't stress that enough. Like, take your time, analyze yourself, do not rush. Think about why you feel the way you do, the root of the problem. I mean, it's hard to address that all by yourself. And in fact, you might not even get to a point where you could fully understand and address the root of the problem, but you could, I think, get to a point where you have analyzed everything about your issue, and it'll eventually, inevitably, I think, lead you to realize that you either have body dysmorphic disorder or you have gender dysphoria. And one of them will come with possibly a future of medically transitioning, which will then give you permanent, not entirely everything is permanent, but you will get some irreversible changes to your body, which is why it's 100% important to take your time before you diagnose yourself with gender dysphoria or run to a gender therapist. I want to also read what causes BDD. BDD is likely due to a combination of neurological, biological, environmental, and genetic factors. Your risk of developing BDD is heightened if you have close biological relatives with BDD. Experience negative childhood situations like bullying or teasing have certain personality traits such as low self-esteem, feel societal pressure to meet certain standards for good looking, or if you suffer from another psychiatric disorder such as anxiety or depression. Now, there are a lot of people that have gender dysphoria and also have anxiety or depression. And I will also add that feel societal pressure to conform to certain, social standards of what a woman or man is. In addition to that, there's a lot of people with BDD that have eating disorders. There's a lot of people with gender dysphoria that have eating disorders. I'm going to scroll down just a little bit and also read this, or some of it at least. It's pretty fairly long. But specifically this first part here, okay, these are things that come with BDD and how it affects your health and well-being. Avoiding mirrors. This is also has a lot. I can relate to that with gender dysphoria. Not allowing your picture to be taken. I can relate to that. Repeatedly combing your hair, shaving, or engaging in other grooming activities. That I can't really relate to, although I would say like there's certain things that I probably, again, I'm focusing more so on pre-transition. I would definitely want to look a certain way or try to look a certain way. Repeatedly touching, checking, or measuring the perceived flaw. I can relate to that, when it comes to hoodie season, that's the best because guess what? Now nobody can see my chest. Awesome. Wearing excessive makeup. No, I can't relate to that. Or growing a beard soles to cover up the flaw. I mean, I guess it could be argued. I could relate to that because I like having a beard. But then again, I don't really at this point, I'm not growing it because I'm hiding anything. I just prefer it. But yeah, I could read further down this list, but it would take a while. But my overall point is there are so many freaking similarities. Sorry to reiterate myself here.
So many, especially young girls, consider themselves non-binary because they don't have dysphoria, but they're not like other girls. They don't like the same things that other girls like. A lot of these women, these young girls, will grow up to be gender non-conforming women and they'll be happy they never transitioned. They'll be happy they never got on HRT. Before we end, there's one thing that I want to say is mm-hmm. that people think that being a cis woman means that you never have any kind of doubt about your gender. Or being a cis, and there are cis women who do, they just go through life and they're like, yeah, I'm a woman, no big deal. Mm-hmm. But especially if you're a butch lesbian, this mm-hmm. is something that is so common that I have seen with so many of my friends. I hated my feminine traits. I hated my breasts, my vagina. I hated everything, getting my period. Puberty sucks for everybody. And just because you have those thoughts of it would be better if I were a man, I should have been born a man, it'd be easier. It doesn't necessarily mean you're trans. It doesn't necessarily mean that you're not supposed to be a woman.
I agree with a lot of what she just said. However, I will add my opinion as well. Overall, just based on what I've researched in this video, conversations I've had with people, videos that I've watched of detransitioners, right? Videos that I've watched of non-binary people, things that I've read on, social media platforms. From my perspective, what I do see is a lack of care and understanding from so-called medical experts treating every single one of us in a very affirming way, not really getting to the root of the problem, not really challenging us. And again, this isn't because I want strict gatekeeping, but I want people to actually help us. Don't just affirm us. Maybe at some point we'll get to that place, right? At some point we'll realize, okay, well, this person in fact is needing to transition and we'll go ahead and affirm them. That's fine. But there should be a process, a more thorough process, a process that doesn't create a loophole. And it really sucks to think that we were pushing so hard to destigmatize gender dysphoria, right? That now we've created this massive loophole. And now at some point, we're going to have to answer a lot of questions. At some point, we're going to have to look at all of these detransitioners and say, yes, we failed you. Not me, but I'm just saying somebody will have to answer to all of these detransitioners because it's not a matter of, oh, well, it's their fault. They should have known better. Maybe on some level, some of them should have, but if you actually look at the age range where when they start to transition and then detransition, a lot of them are transitioning in their late teens, right? And then they're detransitioning in their early 20s. So what that tells me is we are basically trusting that a minor would know what they're doing in regards to transition, only to find out that in fact we don't. We can't trust a minor to decide that. So you see what I'm saying? Now, this doesn't mean that I would say no minor should be allowed to medically transition. There are certain circumstances, I think, that we should do it. We should do it more so on a case-by-case basis. But again, I'd feel way more comfortable if the process was thorough. I'm not for banning HRT for, let's say, somebody at the age of 16, though I would be very, very hesitant as to why that child is transitioning. Because the possibility of them regretting that in 5 years is there. I just wish we would get to this point of discussing the fact that there are different levels of dysphoria. Some people have severe, some people have mild. If you have very mild dysphoria and you're a minor, why would we rush to transition that kid? Why not find a different way to treat their mild dysphoria? And you know what? When they become an adult, if they still have that dysphoria, then they can decide for themselves if transition is right for them. But if dysphoria is mild, why are we rushing to transition everybody? And if there are different levels of dysphoria, why don't we have different ways to treat dysphoria? Why is this not being talked about? And also, again, like if we reflect on this whole video, clearly there's a lot more going on than dysphoria. There's body dysmorphia. There are eating disorders. There is trauma. There is, internalized homophobia, internalized misogyny. Some women are not comfortable being women. Some women are not comfortable being butch women. I mean, the list goes on and on again. And are these things that we're discussing with somebody when they walk into a gender therapist office and they express the fact that they're not comfortable with, you know, being a woman? Like, are we actually addressing all these points to get to the root of the problem? Because I have a feeling we're not, because we're living in this really bizarre time where we're affirming everybody, because if we don't, feelings get hurt, people die. But my question to you is this: if trans kids are just all going to die if we don't affirm them, well, I'm sorry, but I think that would have been a pretty huge epidemic that we would have seen statistically years ago. But where are those stats? Where are the stats showing that trans kids that weren't affirmed 10 years ago all just like jumped off a bridge? You're not gonna find them, because that isn't a thing. Now, that doesn't mean that I'm not going to acknowledge the fact that some kids are trans and some of these kids that are trans have severe dysphoria. I completely get that. And I'm not saying don't get them help. I am. I'm just saying that not every kid needs to be thrown into puberty blockers, because inevitably, that's already a fucking gateway to lead to transition. What I am also saying is there should be other ways to help trans kids. I believe in helping trans kids, and if you believe in helping trans kids, we should be talking about why there's only one way to treat dysphoria. I don't believe in ignoring a child who's dysphoric. I believe in finding the best method to help that child. I don't believe in a future of detransitioners. But I also don't believe in a future of transitioners. The numbers shouldn't be increasing in any way. We shouldn't have a rise in detrans or a rise in trans. That's insane. I'm sorry, but being trans isn't an easy life. And fuck, I can't imagine that being a detransitioner is an easy life either. So, with that said, leave me a comment down below. Let me know what you think. Hopefully you got something out of it, and please consider what I'm saying. And if you disagree, I'd love to hear why. Take it easy until next time. Peace.
There's a lot of different issues that can manifest as something that looks like dysphoria. But basically the way I've come to describe it is there's what I describe dysphoria as a cause and dysphoria as a symptom. And dysphoria as a cause is, in my opinion, generally is something that starts young, and it doesn't really matter how much you dig in, you won't really find some kind of like root cause, like being assaulted or something like that. Whereas there seems to be a lot of people who have dysphoria as a symptom, where it's like something else has happened, whether it be like sexual assault or just discomfort with body development that they haven't adjusted to yet, or so on. When they do eventually manage to work through that root issue, then they no longer have the cause for dysphoria, and then all of a sudden they're left in a modified body that really wasn't required in order to treat what they were actually dealing with.
Do you understand? There are people that are going to find it confusing. They're not going to respect the fact that you've changed and then changed again. Or, like, there's going to be all different kind of opinions, yeah? But if it's valid to you, then that is what matters. Do you get what I'm saying?